Sunday after the Epiphany is from Nehemiah chapter 8. All the people gathered as one man in the square before the water gate. And they told Ezra the scribe, bring the book of the law of Moses that the Lord had commanded Israel. So Ezra the priest brought the law before the assembly of both men and women, and all who could understand what they heard on the first day of the seventh month. And he read from it facing the square before the water gate, from early morning until midday, in the presence of the men and women, and those who could understand. The ears of all the people were attentive to the book of the law. And Ezra opened the book in the sight of all the people, for he was above all the people. And as he opened it, all the people stood. And Ezra blessed the Lord, the great God, and all the people answered, Amen, Amen, lifting up their hands. They bowed their heads and worshipped the Lord with their faces to the ground. They read from the book of the law of God clearly, and they gave the sense so that the people understood the reading. And Nehemiah, who was the governor, and Ezra the priest and scribe, and the Levites who taught the people, said to all the people, This day is holy to the Lord your God. Do not mourn or weep. For all the people wept as they heard the words of the law. Then he said to them, Go your way, eat the fat, and drink sweet wine, and send portions to anyone who has nothing ready. For this day is holy to our Lord. And do not be grieved, for the joy of the Lord is your strength. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Nor again the head to the feet, representative parts are treated with greater modesty. The more representative parts do not require. The body so composed the body, giving greater honor to the part that lacked it, that there may be no division to the body, but that the members may have the same care for one another. If one member suffers, all suffer together. If one member is honored, all rejoice together. Now, you are the body of Christ and individually members of it. And God has appointed as a church, first, apostles, second, prophets, third, teachers, then miracles, then gifts of healing, helping, administrating, and various kinds of calls. Are all apostles? Are all prophets? Are all teachers? Do all work miracles? Do all possess gifts of healing? Do all speak with tongues? Do all interpret? But earnestly desire the higher gifts. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We stand.
Passing through against you went away. The This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Rejoiced in, listened to, or endured, and perhaps all gave up. some special ones, a special family gathering, maybe at a high-class restaurant, maybe a particular picnic at a family reunion, it's about this. But most of the time, you kind of know what you like, you eat what you like. And again, if you're like me, it might be the case that I'm not quite sure what I ate 2 days ago. Nevertheless, here we are, at least well-fed enough to be in church. The Word of God is very much like that, isn't it? You get the Word of God, the bread of life, and it nourishes and sustains you. Nevertheless, there are sermons that you remember. And I guarantee you the people that were there that day remembered what Jesus said. Not because they thought it was such a great sermon. Actually, because they thought it was such an offensive one. It's kind of weird if you read this in our English text. It sort of sounds like everything's going on the right track. Well, last week we talked about Jesus and the miracle at Cana, water and wine. It was a thumbs up. Everybody was happy. Now he goes to his hometown and he takes the role of an adult Jewish male who can talk in the synagogue, especially what is considered learned. He reads from the scroll of the prophet Isaiah, and he sits down. That's the way they did it there. Instead of the pastor standing up, people sitting, we reverse that. And he starts to say to them the words that you heard me preach, words of prophecy about the Messiah. Today, right here, right now, this scripture is being fulfilled. By your hearing of these words, you are receiving sight and blind, and you are receiving forgiveness, and you are receiving liberty and new captives. And this is the year of the Lord's favor. And then we read, and also well of him and marveled at the gracious words that were coming out of his mouth. So far, so good. It sounds like we've got a group of believers. It's really not what they're saying. Here's another reading. They were all testifying with regard to him and marveling at the words of grace that were coming out of his mouth. That sounds a little different. Gracious words, it's words about God's grace and favor for them. And they weren't speaking well of him, they were marveling at them in the sense of, can you believe that God just said that? And they weren't happy about it. They were first shocked, and then they were offended, and then they were angry. And their anger broke out in violence. Let's throw him off the cliff. I pray to God I never have been in that position. I'll say something so offensive to you and so awful that you think it'd be a good idea. Well, fortunately, I don't even know any cliffs here, but there are some high buildings in the area. The point is, what is so offensive about what Jesus said, especially when we read and we hear that these are words of grace? Well, I suppose you can start with the enemies. And there you can see. Jesus is claiming not only to be the Messiah, but also he's claiming to be continuous in continuity with the Old Testament prophets. And those Old Testament prophets, God sent to his people, and they preached repentance and the forgiveness of sins through faith in the Word of God and the Gospel. And what did the people do? How did they react? For the most part, nay. So, to whom does God send his prophets? Well, we have two examples. Days of Elijah, the heavens were shot up, and God sent Elijah to a foreigner in the land of Zarephath and Sidon to a woman who was a widow. And then there were lots of lepers in the time of Elisha in the land of Israel. Instead, it's Naaman, a Syrian, who receives God's healing. Now that's the first and most obvious reason for their anger. You're saying that these words of grace are not really for us, because we don't still think that we are favored by God, but we do not hear the call to repent, and we do not see in you, Jesus, the Savior. And so they reject him. But I think as well, digging back further, there are other answers to the question, why did they take offense at Jesus? For instance, Jesus says, surely you will see the sign, right? The things that you did elsewhere, do here. We need a sign. There's another name for that. It's called putting God to the test or tempting God. Do you remember the kid when I was in high school? So I'll believe in a God if I take this pebble in my hand and let it go. If it just hovers in the air, then I'll believe in God. What is he trying to do to God? He's trying to be God's God, trying to make God do what he wants. He wants God to serve him. If I was smart, I probably have more now than I used to be. I said something along the lines of, well, actually, you should probably just thank God he doesn't strike you dead and blind on the spot. If he doesn't do that, then there is a God. It's pretty much amounts to the same. Asking for signs from God can be a sign of unbelief in itself. This means we don't pray to God in the hour of our need, when in the hour of utmost need we know not where to look for aid. We just sang that a few minutes ago. We do look to God for aid. But we ask as sons, as people who are servants to Him, asking something of Him. Not as Lord to demand things from him. So that was our first mistake. And the second thing that Jesus does that incurs their offense is the scripture reading itself. It's a beautiful passage. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has anointed me. The word anointed there, he has Christed me. Right? Remember your catechism, the word Christ means anointed. And what does he anoint me to do? What's the purpose, the mission? Give the gospel to the poor, proclaim liberty, freedom to the captives, recovery of sight to the blind. You know, Jesus did all of these things in actual miracle form, delivering people from captivity to the devil, proclaiming the good news to those who were rejected by the world, and setting anyone who believed in him at liberty. Indeed, the presence of Jesus is the year of the Lord's favor, the year of grace. He did all of those things, but they would not believe it. They refused to accept that this poor Nazarene, whom they knew, thought he could be his savior. This is an early indicator of the sign of the cross, right? That we do not find salvation in heroic deeds or great acts of valor, but we find salvation in the humiliation, suffering, and death of Jesus Christ, which really is valor, and which really is courage and bravery. It just doesn't look that way. It looks like rejection. It looks like nothingness. It looks like, who is he? We know his parents. He's a nothing. But he is not a nothing. For those who have eyes to see, he is king. And Lord of Lords, that humble man from Nazareth is the creator of heaven and earth. He is the author of our salvation. For his faith as well as for ours, for who is the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, will be saved. But it is through the cross that we have salvation. And that maybe brings us to the third thing. The Israelites truly believed that their salvation was going to be based the law of God, which included a whole lot of things, their birthright as Israelites, but also the degree to which they kept God's laws. That's why they didn't really have a place in the sinners, the tax collectors, the unrighteous, rejected them. The good righteous people were in church on Saturday. Those other ones weren't. Therefore, they're rejected by God, right? Because Jesus' ministry continues. Go and eat with them, sinners and tax collectors. He doesn't seem to be keeping the law. He rejects.
that's the Sabbath day. Look, his disciples are plucking grain and eating it from the fields. Awful. And yet he's saying, he is the one who brings the fulfillment of the law. He brings the gospel. The law of God is good and wise and sets its will before our eyes. But in the end, it dooms to death those who transgress. The gospel announces the Father's grace and his goodness, forgiveness and life through the life, suffering, and death of Jesus Christ. And your participation in his life, suffering, and death at the font and holy baptism and at the altar and holy communion. And when you hear the words of grace that are spoken to you, as they have been this day and are, that your life, your salvation, your forgiveness lie in Christ, the Savior. For indeed, the good news has come to us. We widows of Sidon, we lepers of Syria, we who have been contaminated by sin, and contributed to it by our own neglect, by our own offense. So we come to judge Jesus and his word, to be judged by it. So when it says, you sin, you deserve death. You deserve hellfire. Probably ought not to make jokes, but instead say, it is true. Lord, have mercy on me, the sinner. Christ, have mercy on me, the sinner. Lord, have mercy on me, the sinner. His word to you is the word of grace. I forgive you your sin. That's why I shed that blood. That's why I poured out my life. This is why I am the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Rejoice, glad. Rejoice. As Ezra told the people of Israel in Nehemiah's name. Rejoice. The word of the law, Torah, is ultimately good news. It's goodness. Grace now done in Jesus the Savior. So we praise him. Praise the one who breaks the darkness of sin in our lives. We'll do that by singing verses 1 and 3 of hymn 8.
Holy God, holy and most gracious Father,
have mercy on us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory.
Thank you.